Sushruta for Neet is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
Hi everybody, I am Professor G.K. Bhatt. Hearty welcome to Jnanamarga.in biology classes. In the last class, we have looked into the two of the important body fluids concerned with the circulation. In that, we have studied the components of the blood. And we have looked into the details of the formed elements and the plasma. In today's class, let us look into blood groups and other details. As you know, the blood of we humans differ in certain aspects, even though it looks similar. Blood appears similar. You are aware? While donating the blood, it is not that everyone can donate the blood to anyone. Because in some cases, such a blood transfusion may result in the death of an individual. It may be fatal. Why it happens so? We have to look into. In humans, there are two groups, such as ABO blood group and RH blood group. Two types of blood grouping has been done in our blood. One is ABO type and another one is RH. These two are looked into at the time of blood donation or at the time of blood transfusion. Now let us look into ABO grouping. What does it mean? Human blood is classified into four types based on the presence of or absence of two surface antigens which are present on the plasma membrane. The antigens are A and B. So, based on the presence of antigen A and antigen B, or on the absence of these antigens, our blood group is classified into four types. Just like the antigens that you have on the plasma membrane of RBC, if you look into the plasma, in the plasma, we encounter antibodies. These are the natural antibodies which exist in our blood plasma always. So the plasma of different individuals contain two natural antibodies, either one of them or both of them or none of them. So based on these antigens and antibodies, their presence or absence, human blood is classified into four types: AB, and O. Let us study the details of this. In this picture, what you see is antigen A on the plasma membrane of RBC, red blood corpuscle. These are the antigens. In the same way, here you see now B antigens. Antigen A is seen in the RBC of A group individual. Antigen B in the RBC of B group individual. Whereas in AB group individuals, we come across both antigen A and antigen B. And in O group individuals, in your group individuals, there are no any antigens, neither A nor B. So, the distribution of antigens and antibodies in the four groups of blood, A, B, AB, and O, are given in this table. Look here. I have just mentioned that human blood is grouped into four based on the presence of antigen or antibodies. Blood group A individual, as you can see very clearly, blood group A individual has antigen A on RBC and antibody B in the plasma. Antigen A in the RBC, antigen B in the plasma, and who can donate blood to A? A group individual can donate to A group person, or O group individuals can also donate blood to A group person. In the same way, if you look into B group person, B group person has B antigen on the RBC and anti-A antibody A in his plasma. And who can donate the blood to B group person? Other B group individuals and O group individuals. When you look into AB group individual, AB group individuals have antigen A as well as antigen B, and in his plasma there are no antibodies. And AB group individual can take the blood or receive the blood from AB individuals, A individual, B individual, and O individual, O group of people. Now, O group individuals have no antigens on the red blood corpuscle plasma membrane, but O group individuals have antibodies A and antibodies B in their plasma. And only they can receive the blood from O individuals, only from O individuals. So, this is the table. which shows you the blood groups and donor compatibility. What is this donor compatibility? That means who all can give the blood to these individuals? Compatibility is whether when the blood is mixed of two of these individuals, A group with other donors, B group with other blood group donors, whether the blood mixture or mixing of the blood is smooth or whether it is going to be to have agglutination. So in this way, we have many blood groups and their compatibility with the donor is mentioned in this table. Let me just give you some more information with regard to this. Therefore, I make it very clear to you. I shall make it very clear to you that you have A group individual, they have A antigen, B antibody. B group individuals, they have B antigen, A antibody. AB group individuals, they have A and B antigen, no antibodies. And O group individual, they have no antigen, but A and B antibodies. Right? The same thing I shall show you in this particular another slide. Look here. Here, I am using another word. Whatever I used to call antigen, they are also called by another term, agglutinogens. They are also called agglutinogens. Antigens are also called agglutinogens, and antibodies are also called agglutinins. Agglutinins. Agglutinogen and antigen, they are one and the same. Agglutinin and antibodies, they are one and the same. Look here in this picture. A group individuals have A antigens on the surface of RBC. What you see here, red? Red blood corpuscle. They have A antigen on RBC, B antibodies. These are the antibodies. What picture you see here? These are the antibodies. B antibodies in the plasma. B group individuals have B antigen on the RBC, A antibody in the plasma. AB group individuals have A and B antigens on the RBC, no antibodies in the plasma. And O group individuals have no antigen and A and B antibodies in the plasma. A and B antibodies in the plasma. This you have to keep it in mind. Let us see now how this blood grouping is done. In the year 1900, this particular aspect is not mentioned in the NCERT book. Details, whatever I am telling now. In 1900, a Viennese pathologist named Karl Landsteiner identified A, B, and O blood groups in humans. He identified A, B, and O blood groups. Karl Landsteiner. Later, two of his students, De Castello and Sturley, identified the fourth blood group AB. Fourth blood group AB. A, B, O, these three blood groups were identified only by Karl Landsteiner. These three blood groups only. AB blood group was added later by his students, De Castello and Sturley. Right? Look into the picture of Landsteiner. ABO blood group system is widely credited to have been discovered by the Austrian scientist Karl Landsteiner, who found three different blood types in 1900. He could notice A group person or B group and A and O group in the human blood. For this, he was awarded Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in the year 1930 for this work. Right? But please know something little bit peculiar, which you might not be knowing that. What is it? there was a person at the same time by name Czech serologist Jan Jansky. This fellow, or this serologist Jan Jansky, in fact, he has classified human blood into four groups when Karl Landsteiner has discovered three blood groups in humans. But due to inadequate communication at the time, it was subsequently found that Czech serologist Jan Jansky had independently pioneered the classification of human blood into four groups. He did this independently. When Karl Landsteiner has categorized human blood into three groups, Jan Jansky had categorized it into four groups on his own. But due to inadequate communication and due to his publication mainly in the local language, it was not known to the other scientists or other people of the world. But Landsteiner's independent discovery had been accepted by the scientific world, while Jansky's work remained in relative obscurity. It was not known to the others at all. For the reason that whatever he has discovered, he has not published it in language like English. It was not at all known outside this Czechoslovakia. He is credited with the first classification of blood into four types, A, B, A, B, O, of the ABO blood group system. So, what is the message here, my dear students? Each and every state in India, they wanted everything to be in their local language. Every party is in every state. They are making a big issue with regard to giving importance to the local language. I am not opposing that. One should have definitely love for the mother tongue. I must love Kannada. One must love Malayalam. One must love Tamil. One must love Telugu. But at the same time, whenever we love our mother tongue very much, we should not have any type of dislikings for other languages. If at all we focus on only the mother tongue, we all require one or the other language to keep all of us together and to understand each other better. This is the problem. Suppose I do some research and I don't want to publish this research other than my mother tongue. How the Tamilians, Telugu speaking people, Marathi speaking people, Malayalam speaking people, Orient language speaking people, Hindi speaking people, they cannot understand, they cannot know my research at all. Definitely we should have the love for the mother tongue. At the same time, to make our understanding, to make our knowledge acceptable from other people, acceptable by other people, we must have some language, a common language, to mutually exchange our thoughts. So, because of not publishing in English language, Jan Jansky lost Nobel Prize. If at all it was known, then both Karl Landsteiner and Jan Jansky, both of them would have got the Nobel Prize. Anyhow, frequent voluntary blood donors in the Czech Republic are awarded with Jansky Medal. Now, this is what a Jansky Medal, a bronze medal that is given to the frequent blood donors in Czechoslovakia. Okay, leave it. You probably know that during blood transfusion, any blood cannot be used. The blood of a donor has to be carefully matched with the blood of a recipient before any blood transfusion to avoid severe problems of clumping. We cannot donate the blood of anyone to everyone. Before blood transfusion is done, the blood has to be matched to see that there is no clumping. The donor's compatibility is also shown here, as you already seen. Now let us see what is happening. What is going to happen? Yes, as I told you, A blood group person can donate the blood to A, and O group person can also donate the blood to A. That means whenever O blood group person gives the blood to A group person, it will be smooth mixing. The mixing of the blood will be smooth and there is not be any agglutination or clotting. Right? Look here. This is what you have. These are the donor's blood groups. These are the recipient's blood group. Let us see now what will happen. One drop of donor's blood and one drop of recipient blood. These are two put together. When A blood group and recipient, this is the recipient person, this is the donor. When these two are put together, you can see there is no clumping at all. Clumping means agglutination. There is no agglutination at all. When A blood group is given to B blood group person, see, there are clumpings. There is clumping. When A group person is given to AB group person, no clumping. When A group blood is given to O group person, again clumping. That means it indicates clearly that A group person can donate the blood to A. A group person can donate the blood to AB, but A group person cannot give the blood to B and he cannot give the blood to O. Similarly, if the B blood group or B blood group person, if at all he makes it a point to give the blood to A, no, there will be clumping. To B, no clumping. To AB, no clumping. But when the B group person gives the blood to O, again there is clumping. AB group person cannot give the blood to A because clumping will be there. Cannot give the blood to B, again clumping happens, but can give the blood to AB, and again cannot give the blood to O. O group person can give the blood to A, can give the blood to B, can give the blood to AB, can give the blood to O. So this O group person can give the blood to anybody. He is universal donor. AB group person can receive the blood from everyone. Can receive blood from A, can receive blood from B, can receive blood from AB, can receive blood from O. He is universal recipient. O group person can donate the blood to A, can donate the blood to B, can donate the blood to AB, can donate the blood to O. So he is universal donor. I hope it is well understood. Now, what we do actually, this blood group typing, I got an opportunity to do the blood group typing of the students right from 1980s until 2007. Nearly 25 years plus, I have done this blood group typing for the students wherever I used to serve for, and my students only used to do this for the entire college students where they were studying. And I trained the students to do this. And we used to just celebrate, know your blood group, hurry up, know your blood group under that campaign. continuously for nearly 1 to 2 months, we used to identify the blood group of each and every student, and we used to give the slip to them. Yes, your blood group is dash and dash. We used to mark it on their college identity card. How we used to do this? Just for your information, I'm just telling you. You get the slides in the zoology department or botany department. There will be a slide. In this slide, what we do first? We just collect 2 drops of blood at 2 corners. Put 1 drop of blood here, another drop of blood here. And after that, what you have to do? We have to put nearby that, we have to put a drop of anti-serum A, and here you have to put a drop of anti-serum B. Okay, right? Just a minute. Let me bring that anti-serum for you. This is what we get. I hope you see, these are the anti-serums, right? These anti-serums, if at all you open, you'll get these anti-serums like this. They come in 3 bottles. This is anti-A serum, somewhat bluish in color. And this is yellow color, anti-B serum. And this is what have colorless, anti-D serum. Anti-D serum is for identifying whether a person's blood is Rh positive or Rh negative. So generally what I used to do, how I used to train the student, first take one slide. First, I put one drop of this anti-serum A. Prior to that, please, I shall make some correction. Prior to that, I used to get 1 drop of blood here of a person and another drop of blood here of the person. 1 drop of blood here and a drop here. And mark here with the pencil marker or glass marker, A and B. After taking 2 drops of blood, now put 1 drop of anti-serum of equal amount, equal quantity. And next, 1 drop of anti-B serum here of equal quantity, right? I hope you see this. Then, after this, take 2 needles, the same round-headed pins. Take 2 needles and mix this thoroughly. Mix this thoroughly. Right? Thoroughly mix this. Throw that needle. After mixing thoroughly, then take another needle and mix this thoroughly. Everything has to be done quickly without giving any time just for them to clot. Okay, done like this. So, This is with the anti-A serum, blood. This is with anti-B serum. After that, we have to put a cover slip on that. You have to cover the cover slip, place another cover slip on that, and after putting the cover slip, observe under the microscope. If you observe like this, clumping under the microscope, in where you have marked A with anti serum, and no clumping near the other one, where you have marked anti B or you have marked B, no clumping here, the blood group is A. In the same way, if there is no agglutination or no clumping with the A antiserum, but the clumping is noticed with the B antiserum, if the slide is found like this, then the blood group is B. If there are clumpings on both with antiserum A and antiserum B, the blood group is B. And no clumping with both antiserum A and antiserum B, it is O group. I hope you understand this point. In this way, the students used to just find out whether it's clumping or not, and then they used to bring that slide to me, and I used to verify that under microscope again, and then I used to certify that the blood group of so and so is A, B, A, B, or O. But at the same time, we used to take one more slide at the same time whenever we used to collect the blood. One more time, we used to, one more drop, we used to collect on separate slide, and that blood was mixed, put here. And this drop was mixed with another antiserum, colorless antiserum. This is anti-RH antiserum, or we say anti-D, and this used to get mixed. If at all, this was found to be with the agglutination like this, clotting or agglutination like this, the person was identified or the student was identified as RH positive. So we used to mark the blood group of a person, student, as A positive or A negative or B positive or B negative, AB positive or AB negative or O positive or O negative. Like that, we used to identify the blood group for the student, and we used to take the opinion of that student that in case of emergency, whether you are ready to donate the blood. And we used to maintain a register after identifying the blood group of the student. We used to maintain a register. In that register, we used to mark the name of the student, his blood group, and his residential address, and also his willingness to donate the blood, or yes or no. If at all he used to give his consent for donation of the blood in future days, whenever we used to come to know that some hospitals require badly some blood group, we used to send, we used to note his phone number also, we used to call that student, and we used to arrange for blood transfusion. This is what I have done for 25 years whenever I used to serve in the colleges, wherever I used to work for. So this is the best thing one can do, and besides that, I also used to arrange for blood donation camps every year for the benefit of the needy people, and we used to donate this blood to the hospitals where the patients used to were in need of the blood. So I hope this is what you can take it up in your colleges with the consent of your teachers, and see that you are becoming part and parcel of this great service to the community, that is the blood donation. Right? So from the above mentioned table, of course you came to know that O blood group is the universal donor and AB group person is the universal recipient. Now let us look into RH grouping. Another antigen, the RH antigen similar to one present in the rhesus monkeys, RH antigen, just like A antigen, B antigen, another antigen, the RH antigen similar to one present in the rhesus monkeys is also observed on the surface of the red blood corpuscles of majority of humans. Nearly 80% plus individuals used to possess this antigen. Such individuals are called Rh positive. And those in whom this antigen is absent are called Rh negative. So people used to be with Rh antigen present or Rh antigen absent. Those who possessed Rh antigen, they were called Rh positive. And those in those blood, there was no Rh antigen, they are called Rh negative. An Rh negative person, if exposed to Rh positive blood, will form specific antibodies against the Rh antigen. That is why, if the Rh negative person is given Rh positive blood, the Rh negative person's blood starts forming antibodies against Rh antigen. Therefore, Rh group should also be matched before blood transfusion. It is not that just matching the two group with only for ABO blood group. It is also to be done for just finding out whether there is a matching with regard to Rh group. Right? A special case of Rh incompatibility. Incompatibility means mismatching. Compatibility for matching. A special case of Rh incompatibility has been observed between Rh negative blood of a pregnant mother and Rh positive blood of the fetus. What is this? How it is happening? Rh negative blood of a pregnant mother with Rh positive blood of the fetus. Rh antigens of the fetus do not get exposed to the Rh negative blood of the mother in the first pregnancy as the two bloods are well separated by the placenta. However, during the delivery of the first child, there is a possibility of exposure of the maternal blood to small amounts of Rh positive blood from the fetus. In such cases, the mother starts preparing antibodies against Rh in her blood. Let me just elaborate this. Now, what happens? Whenever a Rh positive man marries Rh negative woman. Okay? So, Rh positive man marries Rh negative woman. In Rh positive man, you know there will be Rh antigen. In the blood, Rh antigen is there. In the Rh woman's blood, there are no Rh antigens. So, when these people marry and they get the child, now, in a woman's womb, the child will be growing. And this child may have Rh positive antigen in his blood or in her blood, or may not have. Child may be Rh positive or it may be Rh negative. Right? What you are going to study in the second year portion, you must know Rh positive is dominant to Rh negative. This aspect we are going to study in second year portion, Rh negative. Whenever a Rh positive man marries Rh negative woman, most of the time, around 50% of the time, the child will be Rh positive. Child will be Rh positive. 50% chances there that the child will be Rh positive, or Rh, the child may be 100% Rh positive, or chances are 50-50. Okay. 50% it may be Rh positive or 50% it may not be Rh positive. If the child is Rh positive, now we are thinking that Rh positive man marries Rh negative woman and the baby child is Rh positive. Nothing happens in the first delivery. When the first baby is getting delivered, when the first baby is getting born, at that time, through the placenta, there will be rupturing of these blood vessels at the time of parturition. Through the placenta, some amount of Rh positive antigen enters into the blood of a mother. And this Rh antigen, when it enters into the blood of the mother, in the mother's blood, antibodies they get produced. And these antibodies cannot do anything to the first baby, but these antibodies will be there in the blood. If the same mother becomes a pregnant a second time, these Rh antibodies, whatever that got stored in the blood of mother, they start they start acting on the second baby's Rh antigen. Because second baby also being Rh antigen, positive antigen. So there will be interaction between the Rh antibodies and Rh antibodies in the second. In such cases, the mother starts preparing antibodies against Rh in her blood. In case of her subsequent pregnancies, the Rh antibodies from the mother can leak into the blood of the fetus and destroy the fetal RBCs. So antibodies, they start destroying the fetal RBCs. The details of this you are studying when you take this genetics part of that. This could be fatal to the fetus or could cause a severe anemia and a jaundice in the baby. This condition is called erythroblastosis fetalis. This can be avoided. Now what happens? If at all a mother is Rh negative, father is Rh positive, or a wife is Rh negative, and a husband is Rh positive, if the after the first baby is born, immediately they administer anti-Rh antibodies. Anti-Rh antibodies are administered to the mother to see that these antibodies are nullified. This can be avoided by administering anti-Rh antibodies to the mother immediately after the delivery of the first child. So if at all anyone is there with Rh negative blood, one need not to have any sort of fear thinking that I cannot have second baby is going to be born like that. If at all I get a husband of Rh positive, need not bother at all. As soon as one gets admitted to the hospital, the hospital doctors will investigate what is the blood group of the husband of that woman, and they will, if at all the woman is found to be Rh negative, this is only arises if the woman is Rh negative. Then they'll make all inquiry with regard to blood group of the husband, and if they come to know that this is Rh negative case, the husband's blood group is found to be Rh positive and it is homozygous, then they will administer this anti-Rh antibodies to see that there is no any effect of antibodies on the second child. So these are the individuals who have discovered Rh blood group, Landsteiner and Wiener. These are the two who has discovered this Rh blood group. It is very much necessary that you must know who has discovered ABO blood group, who has discovered AB blood group, who have discovered this Rh blood group. Whenever I say ABO, ABO system includes A group, B group, and O group, right? This is rhesus macaca muleta, in which first time this Rh antigen was discovered. Therefore, we call it by the first two alphabets Rh factor, right? So these are some slides pertaining to that, what happens to the baby. Of course, this again, I shall deal with this all details when I take up genetics in the 12th standard portion. Symptoms of newborn baby with erythroblastosis fetalis, anemia, enlarged liver or spleen, generalized swelling, and newborn jaundice. Right? So, with this knowledge of blood group, ABO and Rh, now let us just look into, or now let us study about the coagulation of the blood. Right? I hope you were there yesterday also, or in my last class. And again, I'm telling, please start the habit of donating the blood once you attain 18 years of age and acquire 45 kg of body weight. And continue this right up to the 60 years of your age. At least start donating blood once in a year at the beginning, and make it twice in a year, and then go for thrice in a year. So, you know, for every 120 days, your red blood corpuscles will be destroyed. So, make it a point to donate blood 3 times in a year and serve the society with the maximum number of blood donation. There is no substitute to human blood. And blood donation is the best service that you can do to the mankind. Okay. Now let us study coagulation blood. You know that when you cut your finger or hurt yourself, your wound does not continue to bleed for a long time. And usually the blood stops flowing after some time. Why? Blood exhibits coagulation or clotting in response to an injury or trauma. This is a mechanism to prevent excessive loss of blood from the body. You would have observed a dark, reddish, brown scum, some sort of aggregation formed at the site of a cut or an injury over a period of time. After you get your body part cut, after 1 or 2 days, you see that some sort of scum formation there. Some sort of thin film of these fibers appear there, right? What is happening? How it is happening? It is a clot, whatever you see there, or coagulum formed mainly of a network of threads called fibrins in which dead and damaged formed elements of blood are trapped. You know, formed elements include red blood corpuscles, white blood corpuscles, and blood platelets. Fibrins are formed by the conversion of inactive fibrinogen in the plasma by the enzyme thrombin. Already we have studied at the beginning that in the plasma, we have three types of proteins, fibrinogens, then we have these globulins, right? And we also come across these thrombins, right? So these fibrinogens, we have these inactive fibrinogens in the plasma, they get converted into active fibrin threads by the enzyme thrombin. Thrombins, in turn, are formed from another inactive substance present in plasma called prothrombin. So prothrombin is an inactive form of thrombin. Fibrinogen is inactive form of fibrin. An enzyme complex, thrombokinase, is required for the above reaction. Thrombokinase is the enzyme. It's also known as thromboplastin. You have seen how these are called in Roman letters as a factor 1, factor 2, factor 3, factor 4. I have taught these all in my last class. This complex is formed by a series of linked enzymatic reaction, what you call cascade effect, involving a number of factors present in the plasma in an inactive state. A number of factors are present in the plasma in an inactive state. All these factors, they get activated once the wound appears in a particular part of the body. An injury or a trauma stimulates the platelets. First, it stimulates the platelets in the blood to release certain factors. Certain factors get released to the platelets, blood platelets, what you know, thrombocytes, to release certain factors which activate the mechanism of coagulation. So first thing is that whenever an injury takes place, some factors get released from the, which is due to the stimulation of the thrombocytes or platelets. And certain factors released by the tissues at the site of injury also can initiate coagulation. What is happening? Let us see that. Calcium ions play a very important role in clotting. This is the very important point that you remember. Whenever these blood clots, calcium ion has its own role. Now let us see what will happen. So these are the factors I have mentioned yesterday. Factor 1 is fibrinogen. Factor 2 is prothrombin. Both these are inactive form. Factor 3 is thromboplastin, also known as thrombokinase, an enzyme concerned with that, clotting. And factor 4 is calcium, right? So you can see here that there are two pathways in which this clotting takes place. One is extrinsic pathway. One is intrinsic pathway. Extrinsic pathway is from outside, and that the intrinsic pathway is within the blood vessel. So extrinsic pathway, damage to tissue outside the vessel. Something happens outside the vessel. So you see that immediately the tissue thromboplastin, that is the enzyme required for that, is released. And here, now this converts inactive factor 10, it gets activated now. as soon as the thromboplastin is released, inactive factor 10, inactive factor 10 gets stimulated and it becomes activated, and this activated factor 10 activates now prothrombin into thrombin. Thrombin activates now fibrinogen to fibrin, and fibrin, because of the factor 9, it forms a blood clot. This is what you have. Not mentioned in the NCERT book, and you must know. Again, I'm telling, whenever some damage happens to the blood vessel, first thing is that the thrombocytes, what do we have? That makes a certain factors to get released, and this makes the thromboplastin to get released. This thromboplastin, whenever it gets released, the factor that is present in the blood, inactive factor 10, it stimulates, it gets activated, and this activated factor 10, it activates the prothrombin to thrombin. The thrombin formation activates fibrinogen to fibrin. So here you see one act, it stimulates another act. That act stimulates one more act. So this is what is called cascade effect. If at all the damage to the blood vessel within inside, again, cascade of clotting factors again, that as I have told you, there are many factors that factors make the inactive factor 10 to get activated. Activated factor 10 again activates the prothrombin to thrombin. Thrombin activates fibrin to fibrin. Fibrin is made to form blood clot with the factor 13, right? So this is what you have, how the blood gets clotted at the time of the wound that happens in our body. Okay, cascade effects. So with this, we are going to complete this particular class of today, and I am going to start up with this in my next class. That in my next class, we are going to study about the lymph.